Hello, Skydive Chicago, and welcome to the 2022 Safety Day. I apologize for not being there, as I'm attending a wedding in Phoenix right now. But I want to welcome you to the 2022 Safety Day. I want to thank Albert, USPA Executive Director, for coming to attend our Safety Day. And I cannot wait to get this season started, as it is jam-packed, full of events, from competitions, beginner events, world records, Summerfest, Nationals, you name it, we got it. So I'm not going to take too much time, but I want to say thank you for being here and a part of the 2022 season. And just one note, I know the jump prices are going to be at a little bit of a sticker shock this year, but please note, we feel the pain at the pump as well. And know that if the gas prices do come down, the jump prices will reflect it. So let's get started with a great 2022 season.
And then, so how this is going to kind of run, Albert, raise your hand, Albert. He's the executive director of the USPA. He's going to be given the fatality report, which is nice. I've been doing it for about 10 years, and it's nice to take a break. So he's going to be doing it.
Okay, can you guys hear me? Yes. All right, thanks everybody for coming out, and thanks for having me. I came out from Fredericksburg, where I work at headquarters. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Albert Birchtold. I'm the executive director for USPA, so I manage the office, which means I'm the guy that gets called when the toilets get stopped up or the rain leaves get stuck in the gutters at headquarters. Yeah, the most important person, right? I've been jumping for about 20 years. I started in 1999, so I guess 23 years now, okay. Tonight I'm gonna run you guys through, first off I'm gonna start out with running you guys through the fatality summary. Some of you may have looked at this online, some of you may not have, but I've had the unfortunate pleasure of living through a lot of these for the last 12 months. So I think it's an important part of what we do is taking time to review the accidents that have occurred in the prior year. That way we can all learn from them, right? Unfortunately, the folks who are featured in this presentation are not here to tell us about it. So the best thing we can do to honor them is learn from the mistakes of the past. So first off, here's what we're going to kind of do today. First off, we're going to have a little group discussion about some improvements that you guys think could be made here in your lives at your drop zone. Then we're going to talk about each of the individual fatalities that occurred by category. We're going to look at the lessons learned from each of those fatalities. We're going to look at some fatality trends over the last 60 years. We're going to look at fatalities by licenses and the index, fatality index, over the last six decades. So first off, can anybody think of any items that you think could be done either in your own personal skydiving or here at the drop zone to help improve safety in 2022? Does anybody have any ideas?
Altitude awareness.
Altitude awareness. That's a good one. Some of the fatalities we're gonna look at have were directly because of loss of altitude awareness. Yep.
Gear checks.
That's an important one. Yep. Anybody else?
Pattern awareness.
Yep. Landing incidents. We're going to look at the fatalities here and knowing what goes on in the landing pattern is probably one of the most critical times in skydiving where we see a lot of injuries occur. So that's a great one. Anybody else?
Personal health.
Mental, feeding, hydration.
Yep. We're gonna talk a little bit about that. That's a good one. Physical and mental health, both very important in the sport. So here's a quick rundown of the fatalities that occurred in 2021. There were 10 fatalities in the year, which is an all-time low since we started record keeping on fatalities. Three of them were intentional low turn. One was an unintentional low turn. One was a landing problem. One was incorrect emergency procedures, one was a low cutaway and reserve deployment, and three of them were medical problems. As a jumper, it's important obviously for you to look at these and understand what happened and what you can learn from them. And at USPA, we look at each one of these fatalities as well as all the non-fatal incidents that occur throughout the year and try and identify any trends that might be occurring and anything we can do if we see a trend to help convey that out to the community. For instance, in 2019, we saw four incidents very quickly in the year that had to do with failure to execute emergency procedures and resulting in delayed reaction, low cutaways, or no cutaway. And that's when USPA launched the Don't Delay Cutaway campaign. So every time you see something like that, the data that we receive at USPA headquarters allows us to put out those alerts to the skydiving community so that everyone can learn from mistakes, whether they be fatal or non-fatal. We'll talk about the three that were medical problems. So two of those were physical. One of them was a mental illness. As you can see, in the last 20 years, there's been 26 fatalities due to physical illness and 14 in the last 20 years due to mental illness. So about once every other year, there's one that's related to a mental illness, which typically is a suicide. It's usually about once every other year we see one. So the mental health related was a 74-year-old jumper, approximately 17 years in the sport, made a three-way skydive, uneventful jump with two other jumpers, uneventful breakoff, was seen under canopy flying off. And at about 400 feet, he cut away his parachute and landed off in the woods. He had disconnected his RSL. It was later found that he had cleared out his desk at his office, so everything indicated that it was a suicide. So obviously life is difficult for everyone. Two were related to physical illnesses. First was a 76-year-old jumper, 45 years, more than 20,000 skydives. Seven-way jump, normal freefall skydive, normal breakoff, normal deployment. The drop zone where this occurred, they had a split landing area where folks come in from opposite directions and then land in one final direction. So they split the main landing area to have left and right crosswind legs. And in this particular jump, the jumper who died didn't turn onto his final approach, continued on, and almost had did have a canopy collision. The other jumper survived, was able to flare and land. Unfortunately, the jumper who passed away, he ended up catching his camera on the pilot chute of the other jumper, which ended up actually snapping his vertebrae. After the fact, when they looked back at eyewitness accounts and the autopsy, it was found that he had massive coronary or artery blockage, and he actually had died of a heart attack, so it became apparent that he was incapacitated long before the collision. The other one, the second one that was physical illness, a 73-year-old jumper, 50 years in the sport, 16,000 skydives. He was a three-way jump, uneventful free fall, uneventful canopy deployment. He was seen overflying the landing area, limp in the harness. They looked at his camera footage afterwards. And you can see after deployment, he reached up to try and undo his toggles, and then you see his hands fall out of the camera. So autopsy showed that he had a coronary event, also had arterial blockage, and had a heart attack. What can we learn from these? So first off, on the mental side of things, suicide is a significant cause of death in the United States. About 47,000 people in the year of 2019 died of suicide. That's about twice the amount of people that die of homicide. It's a large issue. We see it in our sport, 14 in the last 20 years. So a little bit more than one every other year. Take care of each other, right? If you see somebody who you know, who you love, who's having trouble, talk to them. If you can help them, help them. If you can't, have them get help. On the physical side of things, again, this is something we see pretty regularly. There's about 659,000 people who die each year of heart disease. About one quarter of all the deaths in the United States, about 12% of the population. If you take all of the coronary issues that can occur, it jumps up to about 48%. If you count in heart failure, stroke, high blood pressure related. We had one fatality last year from a low cutaway, low reserve deployment. This jumper was 59 years old, 25 years in the sport, had approximately 1,000 jumps. I was making a solo skydive. It wasn't on a commercial drop zone. It was on a private farm. This person and their family jumped there regularly. They had their own Cessna. They would get together as a family and jump. Got out of the plane at about 6,000 feet. Looked like the deployment was somewhat normal. May have been a hard deployment. When they found the jumper, there were some lines broken on the canopy, so possibly had a hard opening and might have been disoriented. At an unknown altitude, this person cut away their canopy, deployed the reserve within sufficient time for the reserve to get out. So partially deployed reserve, and she died at the scene. So what can we learn from this? Practice our emergency procedures and rehearse them regularly. And that comes to what to do and what altitude to do it at. The don't delay cutaway campaign that happened a couple years ago was very important. We've seen a lot of fatalities over the year that have to do with failure to act and failure to have that situational awareness that's needed. If you're in a malfunction situation, there's times when you have to do the things, there's altitudes you have to do them by, and failure to act in a timely fashion and have that situational awareness can have a pretty bad outcome. So next up, incorrect emergency procedure. This fatality was a 57-year-old jumper, about 35 years in the sport. She had stopped jumping for a while, had about 2,000 jumps, started about two years ago again, and had about 40 or 50 jumps. Normal free fall skydive, was doing a 9-way jump. They had a minor free fall collision near breakoff time. She left a little bit early and wasn't seen again until about 1,200 feet. She had two canopies out in a downplane. She managed to get that downplane back into a side-by-side, and then at about 200 feet, it turned back into a downplane until she reached the ground. It's presumed that it may have been a pilot shoot and tow, which when she deployed the reserve, released enough pressure off the main to allow that main to come out, and ended up with a two out. So understanding your emergency procedures and what to do in a two out scenario, whether that's in a biplane, a side by side, or a downplane, and what to do in those situations is really important. So hopefully you guys go over all that. If you end up in that downplane situation, if she had cut away from it when she had it the first time up higher, and hopefully that main would have gone away, she would have been able to land under that reserve without a problem. Next one, one fatality from an unintentional low turn. This jumper was 28 years old, jumping about 2 years, had about 72 jumps, was under 167 square foot parachute, loaded at 1.2, was working on accuracy. Big landing area, was trying to land in the P's, got to about 150 feet, was directly over the P's, and instead of just flying off and landing and missing the target, decided to do a 360-degree turn with the canopy and managed to land really close to the P's, but unfortunately did not survive that landing. Remember our landing priorities. Who knows their landing priorities?
Land. Safe, open. I'm sorry. In an open area.
Land with a level wing. Land in an open area. Flare if you can. Prepare to PLF. So whether you call that 3 or 4, there's your landing priorities. I forgot they were on the board. Next fatality was a landing problem, non-turn related. This jumper was 42 years old, 2 years in the sport, about 500 jumps, was under 150 square foot canopy, loaded at about 1.3. It started his crosswind leg, overshot the landing area a little bit, turned back a bit more than a 90 degree turn. At that time, he realized he was on level with some other jumpers. So in order to get down before the other guys that he had caught up to in the pattern, decided to pull down on both front risers, and lost situational awareness and ended up holding those front risers all the way till he reached the ground. So was not turning at the time, but hit the ground at a high rate of speed, and he died a couple days afterwards in the hospital. Again, landing problems. A lot of the issues that we run into, a lot of the fatalities this year had to do with landing issues, whether they be turn related or not. Next up, this was the other large section of the pie, three fatalities due to intentional low turns. The other area where we had three fatalities was in the medical area, but there's a commonality that we're seeing in these intentional low turns. And that is, in the past 20 years, There's a, the similarity is that a lot of the time it's a male jumper, 1,000 jumps or less, rapid downsizing, and getting into high performance landings. We really need to do a little bit better job on this and pay attention to what we're doing. First one was a 26-year-old jumper, 3 years in the sport, 430 jumps, was an AFF instructor, was in an AFF instructor certification course, jumping a 135 square foot canopy at 1.3. At about 400 feet, he reached up, grabbed both front risers, pulled them down, slowly let the other one up, and did not recover before reaching the ground. The second one was a 35-year-old jumper, about 7 years in the sport, 1,000 jumps, 87 square foot canopy. This gentleman had, this was actually a demo canopy he'd gotten from a manufacturer. It was found that he was not truthful in the information he gave to that manufacturer to get that demo canopy. He also went and jumped at a different drop zone than he normally jumps at, and did not disclose that he had changed his canopy before doing so. So he kind of hid the fact that he had a canopy that he wasn't supposed to be on. Low turn and struck the ground before recovering. The third one was a 31-year-old jumper, 5 years in the sport, about 600 jumps, 135 square foot canopy loaded at 1.8, rapid downsizing. This one was low turn, downwind. After his turn, managed to get his hands back on the risers, but provided no input, hit the ground. This one, the autopsy showed the toxicology report that he had a blood alcohol level of 0.22. This one, one of the other earlier ones I mentioned, that when they do autopsies on these, and one of the reasons that it takes a little while for USPA to get this fatality summary all together is we usually look to try and get a copy of that autopsy to better understand what happened to the person, how they died, because it helps tell us what really occurred. So one of the other ones that I talked about earlier, actually the gentleman had, there was a high level of THC in his system to the point that he'd probably smoked pot that day, if not right before getting on the aircraft. And then this one had a blood alcohol level 3 times the legal level limit to drive a car. So there's usually folks that talk to people at the drop zone. There were people that smelled alcohol on this jumper on the plane before it happened. So we'll talk a little bit more about that when we get into the safety culture discussion, but we've got to do a better job of taking care of each other. So this category over the years has continued to be an area that hangs around. As a community, we have to try and do a better job. There's a profile that you see here. There's 3 bullet points that keep coming up. So we've got to do a better job of watching out for this. We have to learn how to fly our canopies on more conservative wing loadings before going and downsizing. The other commonality in a lot of these is that when you talk to people at the drop zone, a lot of the time you hear this on almost every incident and accident, is somebody will tell you that guy was a conservative canopy pilot. He'll be fine on that parachute to downsize. He's a conservative pilot. The canopy doesn't know whether you're conservative or you're an aggressive pilot. The speed at which you go doesn't hurt, and the ground doesn't hurt any less if you're a conservative canopy pilot versus an aggressive one. Whether you're conservative or aggressive, these things can still happen. So landing-related fatalities were about 50% of the fatalities that occurred this year, 3 of them being intentional low turns, 1 unintentional, 1 landing problem. 2 areas where we're most likely to have canopy-related issues. One of them is at break-off time, and the other one is in the landing pattern. We're going to talk a little bit later about briefing and things you can do in the landing pattern and flying the plan and planning out what you're doing. But we see it repeated, and we need to address this, of when you're in that landing pattern, you're in an area that is in general a higher risk area. Now, you've got a big landing area out here at Skydive Chicago, so it's not like everybody needs to land right in front of the hangar. You've got a little bit more space to fly your pattern. Use the landing area, use the big area. If it's crowded up by the front, go land a little bit further away. The longer walk in will be good for your physical and mental health that everybody else, we all also need to work on. So get the extra steps in and land farther away. It'll avoid you from being one of these numbers, and it'll also help you for the physical and mental health. Be cognizant of where you are as well as everyone else around you, right? Where are you now? Where are the other people in that landing pattern? And where will you be 10 seconds from now? And where will they be in 10 seconds from now? So it's anticipating and seeing not just where you're at and who's around you right now, but where are they going and where are you going? And your ability to have that situational awareness and know what's coming and where you're going and where they're going will help avoid running into one of these issues. So to recap, and you guys touched on some of these on the way in, first off, take care of yourself and others. Mental and physical illnesses represent 30% of our fatalities this year. That number of having two or three a year is a constant. And as we are able to lower all the other numbers, that's gonna be a higher percentage unless we can get rid of it. Don't delay, cut away. If you end up in a spinning malfunction, you do lose altitude quickly. So make sure you maintain that situational awareness. Rehearse your emergency procedures so you know what to do in the event of a malfunction, whether that be a high-speed malfunction, a low-speed malfunction, two out, broken lines, whatever it may be. Rehearse all of those emergency procedures, as well as what you'll do if you end up in a low-altitude emergency. What happens if you get cut off? Are you familiar with doing a flat turn? Have you practiced it? What if you have to do obstacle avoidance low to the ground when you're in the pattern? Consider that another emergency procedure that you should probably take some time to think about. And friends, don't let friends downsize rapidly, right? We see it over and over again. I spent 14 years working at Performance Designs, and I had mastered the ability to tell people no on getting smaller parachutes. I did it over and over again. I did it every year, and every year I watched people who I had told no to a smaller parachute go get one somewhere else and hurt themselves on it. And every time I did that, one, it built my strength and ability to know that what I was doing was the right thing, because I knew that if I had been able to get that person to listen and not do that, maybe they wouldn't be in the situation they were in. But I had people that would come back 10 years later and thank me for not letting them make the stupid decision they wanted to make. We all have to try and keep doing that. Don't let your friends get parachutes that are too small for themselves. So now let's look at some of the numbers. First off, this is the fatalities by license. So the blue numbers in the front are this year. The orange numbers in the back are the 10-year average by license. So luckily last year we had no student fatalities, one in the A license, no B, 3C and 6D license, which is down a little bit from the 10-year average of 12. But what do we see from this? The more licenses we get, we don't necessarily get any smarter or any less likely to die, right? Unfortunately. So complacency, right? D licenses make up 32% of our membership, but they make up 60% of our fatalities. Those of us that are in this room that are experienced jumpers, we are in the danger zone, right? So we have to take the time and effort to make sure that we are refreshing ourselves on our EPs, we're learning from the mistakes of others, and we don't let complacency put us on this chart. This is a shot of fatality trends over the last 6 decades. Back here, we didn't have great record keeping. As you can see, numbers have gone down. They've continued to go down. We had 10 in 2021. In the late 70s, equipment started making some drastic improvements in safety, and we started seeing that that number continue to drop. This is a look at those same numbers in 10-year averages. In the 2020s, we're down to 10.5, which is great to see, and that number continues to drop. The nice thing about this is even as you see this number continue to drop, the number of skydives that occur in the United States every year has continued to go up. So that makes us a bit of an anomaly. We're able to continue to lower the total number of fatalities while we watch the total number of skydives go up. So that's a good thing. Let's keep doing that. Again, fatality index. So fatality index is something we do. We're able to calculate by looking at the total number of jumps per year and the number of fatalities that occur per 100,000 jumps. So those numbers along the side you see, in the 2010s it was 0.65. Back in the 60s, it was as high as 5.9 fatalities per 100,000 jumps. So that number has continued to to drop. So in 2010s, there was one fatality per 154,000 skydives. In the 60s, it was one fatality per 20,000. So different ways of looking at those numbers. Again, 0.59 or 5.9 per 100,000 in the 60s and 0.33 in the 2020s. So we've gotten it down pretty low. This year was 0.28 per 100,000. So we'll continue to see that number go down as fatalities decrease, hopefully, and the number of skydives go up. So we'll come back to these again. Our highlights: take care of yourself and others. Don't delay. If you're in a spinning malfunction, you lose altitude rapidly. Rehearse your emergency procedures. You can't do it. You can't do it enough. If somebody says, hey, you want to go practice emergency procedures? There's only one answer to that question. It's yes. Take the time to do it. And friends don't let friends downsize rapidly. We're going to get a little bit more into this when we start talking about safety culture later. But that's what I've got for you guys today. Thank you guys for listening. I tried to keep it moving.
All right. Welcome to the first class, guys. This is emergency procedures. Okay. Looks like most of you guys have probably been in this sport for a few years. Okay, some of you I know haven't been that long, but some of you guys look a little bit longer. My name is Baxter, in short. Some of you guys I met, probably not. I've been an instructor for over 10 years now. I've been skydiving for about 15. This is my third year here in Chicago, and I'm now running the AFP room. Okay, so we're going to go through basic emergency procedures. Tomorrow when you guys come in, this is where we're going to do most of your handle pulling and all that kind of stuff. So we're just going to kind of pretty much do like a little refresher here. So when it comes to emergency procedures, just remember there's more than just under canopy. Right? There's other things that can happen throughout your skydive that you need to be aware of. Okay? However, the biggest thing I think when it comes to emergency procedures is have a plan. Okay? So that when you go up and you look up and whatever the canopy, where you're in the plane, whatever it is, you already know what to do. Okay? There's nothing like sitting under your canopy going, what do I do? Right? So you always want to have a plan. Okay? Whether it's just you see something bad, cut away, fix it, whatever it is. Okay? So when it comes to the aircraft, okay, first question always, who's in charge of the plane?
Pilot.
Pilot, right? So he's gonna yell out commands, right? The biggest thing you can do at that point is just stay calm. Okay, stay nice and relaxed. He might have you stay in the plane. We might be able to do a normal jump run, or you might have to bail quickly. But either way, remain calm. You need to get out quickly. Do it in a, you know, efficient and orderly fashion. You guys remember your altitudes for in the plane, right? What's the first altitude on the way up?
1,000 feet.
1,000 feet. What are we doing at 1,000 feet?
Buckles.
Yeah. So why do we keep our seatbelts on to then?
In case of emergency.
Right. So in case we have to land with the plane, everybody knows the brace position, right? Right. Tuck your head down as best you can. Now, what is the whole? We are jumping out of the plane anyway, so everybody always asks the question: what's the whole point of wearing a seatbelt? You guys know what the point of wearing a seatbelt is?
From sliding forward.
Yeah. Right.
Your bodies.
So exactly. So the seatbelt's not necessarily to save your life, it's to save the guys behind you, right? So in the event of a crash landing, you're not becoming a projectile and squishing the guy behind you, right? 1,000 feet to what's the next altitude for most of us? 2,500 to 3,000 feet, depending on where you land, right? So if we have an aircraft emergency between those two altitudes, what's usually gonna happen?
Get out.
Out on what parachute?
Reserve.
Right. So get out, everybody know the procedure, right? Get out, grab that handle, one, two, pull, right? At that point, you're just clearing the aircraft and then try to land safely. Above 3,000 feet?
Main.
Yeah, at that point, it's just a hop and pop, right? And know your surroundings, right? Because this is where it gets important to look out the window and know where you are, because if you're now 10 miles from the drop zone and you need to bail out, are you gonna, you know, give a delay? Mm-hmm. Probably not, right? Even if you're at 10,000 feet, you might pull a little bit higher because it gives you more time to figure things out, okay? So some basic stuff in the plane, pilot shoots out, doors closed, what do?
Jump on that pilot chute.
Yeah. Right. Let everybody know, like, yeah, I got a pilot chute. It's usually pretty easy to pack our way back in the plane. If the door's open and you're sitting down and you see a pilot chute from behind you go out the door, what are you going to do?
Shut the door.
Sorry?
Push him out.
It's coming out from behind you.
Grab it.
Well, you think you're going to have enough force to grab that and
pull that thing back in. So what do you do?
Push it.
Jump out.
Get up.
All right, one, it's yours.
Right.
And you're gonna go with it regardless. Or two. Or second is the guy behind you.
Yeah.
Right? And now you're going with him anyways, right? So either you see a pilot should go out, you know you're not 100% sure, get out with them. If it's not yours, what are you gonna do?
Push your mouth.
Yeah, pull your parachute. If it's yours, deal with what you get. Main out in the plane. So you're sitting in the plane, somebody's main's out in the aircraft. What's our procedure?
Shut the door.
Yeah. Get the door closed, and what's that guy do?
Go to the front of the
plane. Yeah, collect your stuff. Usually, disconnect your RSL, cut away your main. Why do we do that?
So you don't get pulled out.
Yeah, so if the parachute, for whatever reason, does go out the door, you're good to go. What does everybody else do?
Stay calm.
And probably do a normal jump, right? Right. You get stuck in the plane, holding your gear. If a reserve comes out, what are we doing? So if for whatever reason your reserve's out in the plane, what are you doing?
I'm gonna take the rig off.
Well, door's closed, you're sitting in the plane, what are you gonna do?
Take the rig off.
Yeah, nope, don't take the rig off. No. Right? Still gonna collect your stuff. What's everybody else gonna do at that point?
Remain calm.
And land in the plane.
Yeah.
Right? So at this point, because the reserve's out, you cannot detach it. If that thing goes out of the plane, you're more likely going to take the tail with it and then screw everybody else in the process, right? So if main out, collect, that person stays, everybody else is still good to go. Reserve out. Everybody's out. Everybody lands in the plane. If you're out on the door, right, and you see some of your pilot chutes go, then what do we do?
Let go.
Kick them.
Yeah, get them off the plane, right? Whatever you need to do. Okay. If you're on the plane, you're outside the door on the plane, and you see that plane stall. What do we do?
Go.
Just let go of the plane, and get away. Everybody know what a stall is?
Yep.
Sure.
Right. Just the plane loses all its lift, drops out of the sky. Right. Get off the plane. Get away. That's about the best you can do with the pilot. Deal with it. Here's one probably most people don't know. If you're gonna get sick in the plane, you know, you had a rough night, like you said, you know. Rough night of drinking, you're not feeling too well, you're a little under the weather, you're about to be sick in the plane. What are you gonna do?
Bang the door and throw up out the door.
Yeah, you can't get out the door, what are you gonna do?
Open your jumpsuit.
Do the courtesy for everybody, please.
Take it home with you.
Yeah. It's one thing to be covered in somebody your own puke, but it's another to be covered in somebody else's, right? So if you have the option, just in your jumpsuit, suck it up. Right? It's better than you being puking on the guy in front of you. It's not a lot of fun, right?
You jump after that?
What's that?
You jump after you puke?
I watch people do it. It's totally up to you. I probably don't recommend it because you're probably not feeling well right now. You probably shouldn't have been in the plane in the first place. But if you're feeling sick, you probably may want to stay in the plane at that point, right? All right. Last thing I got for the aircraft is cell phones, helmets, all that loose stuff we like to carry. What do we want to do with this stuff?
Make sure it's contained.
Yeah, keep it in your pocket.
Zipper pockets.
The last couple of years, I've definitely seen a lot of people sitting there on their phones on takeoff. That plane, for whatever reason, goes up and comes down real quick, your phone is now projectile. Mostly everybody would have been okay, but now that phone broke somebody's nose and not a very nice thing to do, right? So here we do helmets on, keep your cell phones tucked away, right? They're nice to have around here in case you land off, but keep everything secure. So that way, if we have a crash, nothing becomes a projectile. All right, free fall. All the fun stuff, right? So when I talk about free fall here, I'm talking about, you know, smaller groups. There are bigger issues when you're doing big waves and stuff like that, but I'm gonna stick to the smaller stuff, all right? So one of the basic things, if you in free fall and realize your altimeter's busted or for whatever reason it falls off,
pull.
What's that? Pull. Yeah, there are a couple situations that if you know you just exited the plane and all of a sudden you fly it off, you can probably give it 5 or 10 seconds and pull. If you realize you're at 6 grand and then see your altimeter again at 6 grand,
pull.
Yeah. It may kick back over, it may not, but don't take that risk, right? If you lose your goggles,
pull. Depends if you can see. If you can see,
right. Pull. Exactly, right? See the situation, right? Sometimes the goggles flip up. If you need to, just make sure both hands. I've watched AFF students do it all the time. It happens. If you're on your back spinning, it's one of the first things we do.
Arch!
Right? It seems like such a simple thing in AFP or AFF, right, at the very beginning that this is the base, because it is, right? So for whatever reason, you're learning new maneuvers, it happens, right? You end up on your back spinning for a second, just relax, take a nice big arch, flip over, get yourself back in control, okay? If you can't get back in control, which I hope most of you can right by this stage in the game. But if you can't, for whatever reason, get that pilot certificate. Right. At that point, it's just better to slow yourself down a little bit, or a whole lot actually, and deal with what you get, right? So stuff when you're jumping with other people, right? So as you get out of the plane, you go out and you lose sight of somebody. Right, so you're jumping with a two-way, you do a 360, and all of a sudden he's gone. What do you do?
Relax, stay stable.
And? Do a scan. Yeah, scan, right? He could just be below, he could above. If you can't see him this way, what do you do? Yeah, do a simple 180 and turn around, right? I don't know how many times I've seen people just continuously do this, looking for somebody, right? And the person's chasing behind them, right? So take a full scan, take a look. However, if you still can't find them, what do you do? Yeah, continue what your normal plan was, right? Stay around, keep searching for him, break off is still break off, okay? Don't assume just because he's gone, he's tracked somewhere else. When it's time to go, you're going to track, then you're going to be extra careful now. Now you're really going to be looking around, making sure you don't see a parachute go below you, that you maybe he got really low. But at that point, break off is still break off. Do your track, keep your eyes a little more vigilant, and still pull when you normally would. You may even want to pull a little bit higher. Make sense? Yeah. Cool. If you collide with another jumper, shit happens, right? A little bit fun to get burbled and all that. You collide with somebody. But what are you going to do when you see something about to hit you?
Hit the ball.
Protect your head. Right. If you need to, put your arms up, protect your head, do what you need to do. However, if you collide with somebody and knock that other person out, and you're just watching them spiral down the spiral, what do you do?
Go get him.
Yeah. Most of you guys are not trained for that. Okay. At that point, they're licensed skydivers. There's not much you can do. Most that'll probably happen is instead of one person in, there might be two. Right. So yes, they're your buddy, but sometimes you just gotta know that little stuff. I know it's a little morbid, but at that same time, you also gotta worry about yourself. If you're starting to track away, or you guys are looking down, and you realize, hey, I'm an extra 2 or 3 miles away from the drop zone. Right? Shit happens. Right? Winds change, spots bad, long climb outs, stuff like that. What do you do? What's the best option? If you realize you're a little far, what can you do? If you can, if you're doing a solo, pull a little higher, right? Two, three ways, you guys can break off
clear
and still
airspace, pull
clear airspace, pull a little bit higher. Even just an extra 500 feet can mean the difference between landing on one side of the river or landing on the other, or landing in the river, right? If you have the option, you can pull just a smidge higher. Make sense?
And yeah. Take your wingsuit back into the gear somewhere.
And do that, yes. So if you're a wingsuit landing off, you probably got some other
That's
stuff.
Normal.
All right, any questions about the free fall? Anybody got anything else for me? I may or may not miss some stuff where you guys don't have an experience. Everybody good? Okay, I'm not putting anybody to sleep yet, am I? Okay, go. Canopy, the fun one. Okay, so this is where I got a nice fancy picture here. Everybody know what this is, right?
It's square canopy.
Yeah, this is what we're looking for, right? Nice square canopy. However, you remember, if it's there, square is steerable, right? Four corners, straight lines, slider down. There are different ways depending on how you were taught, but this is what we're looking for after the canopy opens, right? Guarantee everybody's gotten this one.
Night twist.
Right. This is the nuisance one, right? These are the ones that are kind of minor, and you deal with it. How we deal with this?
Check your altitude.
And?
And then kick out.
Yeah. So there are a couple of different ways to do this. With the finger canopies, it's easier to grab a risers, pull them apart, and scissor kick. Now with the faster canopies, the smaller ones, another technique is what you're gonna do is you can take your risers, push them together, and you're gonna try to bring the twist down into your risers, right? That'll help it bring out your lines, canopy fly a little more flatter, open it up a little more, and then you can kick out of the risers. It tends to be a little bit easier with the smaller canopies, okay?
And self-closure?
Yep, and? There's two things on this one.
Pump it. Flare twice.
And?
Stock slider.
Yeah, stock slider, right? Cool, so the collapsed end cells, what do we do?
Pump the rear risers.
Pump the boots, yep. And the slider?
Re-risers.
Yeah, re-risers, but what's the way we, in the very beginning? Pump the brakes, right? Yes, the risers can tend to work, but one of the easiest ones is also pumping the brakes, right? There's a few different methods of this. What are we gonna keep an eye on in the meantime with all this stuff, though?
Yeah,
right? When do they become an actual malfunction? Yeah, it's 2,500 feet.
Under the hard deck.
Yep. Yeah, where's it supposed to be? Yeah, right. I've watched a few of these land, tandems and students. Doesn't really do much.
4 minutes.
Cool. We're gonna have to move a little faster. All right. All right.
There's a hole.
Oh,
yeah. It's bigger than
tearing the second, third cell yeah. there.
It's bigger. If it's smaller than your head, what do we do?
You do a control canopy check.
Control check.
Right. If it gets bigger, tear it away.
Screamer.
Yeah. Remember, how long does the canopy open?
Not that long.
2 seconds.
Yeah, it takes a few seconds, right?
Yeah.
If you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you look up, your canopy does look like this when it's open, when it's opening, right? A couple seconds usually. If it doesn't get bigger,
okay.
Those ones are obvious.
Bag and tuck.
Bag lock. What do we do? Don't waste time, right?
No. Horseshoe.
Yeah. Pitch. And?
Pitch and release.
Yeah, deal with what you get. Yeah. Right? You might have to cut away, you might not. Right? Quickly go to the two out stuff.
Control the outside.
With what?
Control the outside.
Minimum.
Yeah. What kind of inputs?
Keep the brakes
small. Yeah, small inputs. How do we flare this on landing?
Don't.
No flare, right? We got twice as much square footage. You probably land slow. Pretty softly. How you? What are you be ready to do though?
Hail up.
Good.
Fly the rear.
Fly the rear.
Dominant canopy. Rear risers.
Thank you. That's what I'm talking about. Are the rear risers of the front canopy. What kind of inputs?
Very minor.
Minimal.
Okay. How do you flare it on landing?
Down.
Cool. Anyway, we talked about this earlier, right? Downplane?
Cut away.
When?
When they're as far as they can be.
About one canopy in the middle.
Canopy.
You get about third canopy in between. If you're at 500 feet and you got this, what are you going to do?
Keep.
Cut away. Yeah, cut away. Because it's better off that you get rid of that, you'll get a better chance of landing safely, and then this is not a guarantee. This is a guaranteed smash landing, right? Get rid of that main whenever it happens. The sooner, the better. Okay. All right, so we'll talk about some of the stuff on the ground. So if you do have injuries and stuff, how to get help, right? So if you yourself land, you tumble, you face plant, skid across the ground, I know we've all done it, and you're okay, what do you do?
Stand up,
make sure everybody knows you're okay. If you do hurt yourself, you got that pitcher tiptoe landing, but you break an ankle. I've seen it happen. What do you do?
Stay down,
right? That signals that we're coming to get you. So don't dilly-dally. If you're sitting on the ground, you're okay. Please stand up. Just let us know. Don't need the rush to get you. If you're on the ground and you see somebody else is hurt, not severely, twisted ankle, whatever it is, but they need help, what do you do?
Help. Get help.
One hand. This is, hey, he's hurt. Need some help. It's okay. But, you know, not deathly. If he's severely hurt,
Balting.
Needs help immediately.
Grab your cell phone.
Two hands, right? This is, hey, we need help now. This is immediate. If you have a cell phone on you, don't hesitate to call 911. Okay. I think that's pretty much we're running out of time here. You guys got any questions about the EPs? No, we probably didn't get. We touched on most of the stuff here. But tomorrow, thank you. When you guys come in and do your reviews to get current again, if you guys aren't current, we'll be going into more detail and pulling all of your handles. Cool.
All right.
So if you guys are all up, into the handle.
Check 1, 2.
All right, we're good.
Yeah, so let's talk about some ground safety stuff and work our way up. First, these are our planes. It's important to know where to walk and where not to walk. Situational awareness is gonna be the word that I keep using throughout this 25-minute session. When we're loading the airplane, it's important to listen to your loader and stay behind these wings. It is easy to become complacent and forget that you might not be able to see the propeller, but it is there. There has been more than one instant where passengers have just got out of the aircraft and just wandered around the the plane and walked right in the propeller. It didn't turn out very well for that person. Everyone knows that you have to wear seatbelts. What altitude can you take your seatbelts off?
1,000 feet.
Do you need to wear your helmets?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep. That's correct. 1,000 feet, you need to have seatbelts and your helmet on. If we start rolling and you realize that you don't have your seatbelt or someone else does, how do we deal with that? Do we just kind of let it run, or do we get the pilot's attention and say, hey?
Pilot's attention.
Yep. That's right. The pilot is going to have one main person as a point of contact, and that's going to be on their right side, their first person sitting right next to them. So get their attention, because that is the person that's going to be able to get the pilot's attention the most easiest and most accurate and direct. If everyone's yelling, you know, it doesn't really make sense. So get their attention and say, hey, let's figure this situation out.
Where do you put your seatbelts? Where's the best place to...
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome question, Anthony. So we're going to be putting them on load-bearing straps. That's not your chest strap. That's your harnesses. And that is going to be where you can put those. I see people all the time putting them on their buddies in front, you know, on their shoulder straps, say, you know, you're good to go. That's all good until, let's say there's an emergency and we bring the plane down, and now you're trying to get out of the airplane and you can't, you know, you can't get to your harness. It's, let's have it around your leg straps, because, you know, we're able to undo that by yourself.
What about a wingsuit? The leg straps aren't really exposed.
Anthony, you want to touch on that?
The back left or right lateral. So that's successful if you can kind of get it in through there.
Now we're in the air. We've got to 1,000 feet. We've removed our seatbelts. We're getting excited for the skydive. And we come into a problem. Not every problem is going to be, you know, an emergency that we can't deal with over time or figure out a better solution to get you and everyone back to the ground safely. Situational awareness, whenever you start realizing something's going on, check that altimeter. Realize where you're at and what you're going to be doing next. Then it's your job to look at the pilot or the point of contact, which would be the person to my right, which I will be relaying the information to see what kind of emergency we're dealing with. Are we at 8,000 feet? I mean, we got low oil pressure, just kind of putzing out. Or is it a serious emergency where I'm like, let's roll, bail out. So immediately look at that altimeter and realize what you're gonna be doing. And then wait for the pilot to give, you know, what instructions after that. Let's say we're at 3,000 feet and I say, hey, let's get ready to bail. Does anyone know what altitude you guys will need to either make the decision to pull your main or your reserve?
Yeah.
If I'm at 2,000 feet, what as a sport jumper, which parachute?
2,000 or reserve?
Perfect. 2,500 feet is a good number, your decision altitude, to transition from your main to your reserve. So that just is another thing. Just be situational aware. Get on that right away, and that's going to help you make the best decision for the situation.
What about 1,000 feet below?
Stay in.
Buckle up.
And what's the position you take if you think you may need
it? Brace for impact.
How's that seatbelt going to be? Nice and loose or nice and tight?
Tighten it up if you can.
So you got to remember, more than likely when you crash, it's going to be nose first, which is going to cause everybody to go this way. Keeping that tight will hopefully save your friend's life that's behind you. And the person in front of you won't squash you. So that's important to do that.
If we land on the opposite side or the wrong side of the runway, how are you going to tell the pilot that's landing that you see them and that you're aware that they're coming in?
Turn away from the runway.
Take a knee.
Take a knee.
Grab all your stuff and take a knee.
Turn away.
That just tells us that, hey, we see you coming in, and we're giving you the right of way. We're not going to try anything crazy, try to get to that next load or anything like that. Let's say we get a bad spot where pilot made a uh-oh and threw you out way over the quarry, and you're just rolling, trying to get back to that drop zone, to the landing area. And you're like, I can make it, but I'm gonna come in right over that runway. Does anyone know the altitude that we're gonna stay above the runway?
500 feet.
At this airport, it's 500 feet. Most airports, if you go to other drop zones, like a municipal airport, it's gonna be 1,000 feet. So just keep that number in mind. But
getting back into the plane, say you're sitting next to the door and your pilot chute goes out, what are you gonna do?
Go out.
What if you see your buddy's pilot chute go out the door?
Take
you go
out.
Out. Take them out. Yep. What if you're towards the front of the plane and you realize your pilot chute's out?
Grab it. Gather it up.
Yeah, contain. You're gonna yell, pilot chute out. Yep. And shut the door. And then what are you gonna do after that?
Get them in front of the plane.
Get in front and then inform the pilot what's going on.
You know, everyone wants to give the pilot a, you know, fist pump at jump run, talk to him, say, hey, dude, I'm going skydiving. It's like, cool. I believe it.
That's why I brought you here.
Yeah, so as fun as it is to talk to me, and I love talking to all you guys, when we're getting on jump run, we're slowing these planes down to slow configurations, which brings us closer to that stall speed, along with people moving around and other distractions, talking to ATC, and getting everything lined up for a safe skydive. So as much as you want to say hey to me, let's wait till we get back on the ground or a safe condition.
What altitudes are FAA communications?
When we talk to ATC? So we talk to them as soon as applicable when we take off. We're talking to them throughout, talking with different aircraft to just coordinate flight stuff. So throughout the flight, we're not too busy, but leading up to it, we're giving 5-minute calls, 2-minute calls to the ground, as well as ATC. And so really about that, if you hit 10,000 feet, you guys focus on yourself, do your gear checks, and let me do my stuff up in the cockpit. Go ahead.
I've seen people trip over, and I also trip over two stuff, and it also damages the plane if they go out the door. So I don't know if you
want to
say something. Wow.
Yeah. So, seatbelts, there's definitely different setups, like right here. This can, when this is in the wind, this is just smashing the plane. So if you're towards the back, let's toss them up. Or even better, these aren't bolted down or anything. So we can definitely put, you know, just tuck them underneath, and that's going to prevent those situations. Thank you, Kevin.
Can we reconnect them back together?
No.
Loops are back.
With that being said, moving back to the airplane, the Caravan and the Otter do a really good job on being able to have a lot of skydivers on the exterior. But when you are going to have a big group, it is always helpful to tell the pilot, hey, this is what we're going to be doing, and this is how we're going to do it. Is that cool? Is that okay? Awesome. Generally, we're going to say, go for it. I don't really care. But just that we know that you're going to do that can change what we're going to do up front. Whether that's our airspeed, our flap configuration, can be a lot of different variables. Or we can say, shut it down, that's not cool. So,
always. And everybody else should stay forward when the big group's going out.
Yeah, so that's a great thing to say.
For
so
CG.
You know that, like, let's say we're in the Otter. We got a 10-way going out. You know the first group's big 10-way. Don't just be crowding up next to them saying, hey, I can't wait to get out. Let's give them their space, because one, they're gonna need more separation because they're gonna be tracking further away in every direction, as well as we're moving a lot of weight to the rear already. So let's just keep that CG in balance while they exit. And once they exit, you guys can go do whatever you want. Talking about that, the Skyvan behind you is extremely susceptible to CG variations. In that plane, we have a red line across the ground where 10 people, and that is a firm 10. It's not like, let's talk to the pilot. Like, it doesn't matter what the pilot says. 10 people pass that line, we'll throw the CG off, and we will get into a bad situation. And maybe you've seen YouTube videos, maybe you haven't, but it's pretty violent. Being aware of that, and if you see someone doing it, you know, because that door opens, and I swear the silly button comes on, because you just forget everything. And people will walk towards it and be like, hey man, not our turn, let's just wait, get set up, let them go.
What determines your exit separation? You guys know?
Ground speed.
And how do we determine the ground speed?
The pilot.
The pilot. How fast we are going. So when does that pilot know the ground speed?
At jump run.
All right. So after he cuts the plane. I hear a lot of people, especially on load one, when they're taking off, what's ground speed? We have no idea. We haven't gone up. and when you see, we have it on the board, but do know that it may, what's on a board may not be exactly right when we got conditions change. Sometimes we have to change spot. If we're going into the wind on one jump run and we have to deviate a little bit because of clouds, that's going to affect our ground speed, which thus changes our exit separation. So listen to the pilot, they're gonna call it out. One thing with it, new that we're gonna be having this year, we're gonna be doing some testing, but there's an app called Exit Count. You guys can download it, it's free. Once I'm confirmed that it's really good, we're gonna put these on the back of the airplane, so it gives you real time ground speed and exit separation on there, okay? So if you see that, that's what it is, and it's still technology, it can still fail, but you can use that, and then that'll help us, honestly, just make us all safer, better skydivers with that. With the exit separation, if it's 7 seconds between group, how do you count that? Do you count the seven?
From the time they leave.
Getting out of the plane?
From the time they leave.
Yeah, it's from exit to exit. So if you have a four-way that's not very good, and it's 7 seconds, you should probably start getting out right away. One other thing too is once we get to like 10 seconds, I've seen this a lot, and people just, skydivers can't count to 10 or 15. they freak out. Be calm. When it's like 10 to 15 seconds, we are going so slow. We are gonna have a lot of drift. We're probably gonna be just fine. So take your time. I've been in planes before where we literally looked out and just shut the door between exits because it was so slow. I don't expect you guys to do that, but just when it's that, make sure you're counting correctly so we're not having any collisions.
What's the best way to ask for exit separation? Say you're in the back of the plane and you're trying to figure out what the exit separation, say it's the first load, And you're trying to figure out what the exit separation is at that point. What's the best way to do that?
I mean, if the engine's cut and you haven't heard anything, then you need to be looking at that POC and making eye contact with them so they can tap on the shoulders, the pilot's shoulder. Now it kind of brings up a little thing. So who's the pilot in command, or who's in charge of the aircraft?
Pilot.
Pilot. If they have something to communicate and there's no PA system, who are they gonna talk to?
The person next to them.
And then that person, so if you're not spot, you have to know that you have a job to do and it's very important. If you don't feel comfortable, don't land. It's like being on the exit row of an airplane. If you're not comfortable, don't sit there, all right? Another important position is the person right next to the door. So in an aircraft emergency, something goes wrong, that person that's in a POC is going to wait patiently while the pilot figures out what they're going to do. Once the pilot says, okay, I'm gonna get you back to the drop zone, but we're gonna exit at 8,000 feet, then they're gonna communicate to the person in the door what's gonna happen. Everybody else, your job is to stay quiet and also create and be ready to jump and create a clear line of sight between that door person and the POC, okay?
We bring up that the seatbelt altitude is higher with tandems on.
Yeah, so 1,000 feet for, because you guys can get out a lower for experienced skydivers, and it's 2,000 feet for tandem, so the door has to stay shut. The main reason why is we're in the front of the plane, we can't get out at that low altitude. If you open up the door and your pilot chute gets out and wraps around the tail of the plane, me and my passenger are not going to have a fighting chance to get out. So that's why we have 2,000 feet at tandems. I know a lot of other drop zones, they don't do that, but I think I'm really important one to survive in real life. So that's why we have 2,000.
So past 2,000 feet, say we reach 2,000 feet, do we just open the door?
Oh, that's correct. No, you're going to wait for a tandem instructor to say door, because we have to make sure that they're clipped up properly. Yep, so it's 2,000 feet. If you're that door person, take visual contact. What we do as tandem instructors is we give a thumbs up. That gives the sign to the POC that we are all hooked up, and then they yell door, and then you guys can open the door. Yeah, checking pilot chutes, and if everybody should be doing that, but especially by the door, you should be checking your pilot chute before you open it up. Another, when you're getting up, if you're leaning against the bulkhead, and if you had a good winter like me, it might be a little difficult to get all the way up. Don't be afraid to ask a friend to help you. Do not scrape that rig. I see it all the time and it frustrates me. And I've even caught a few times where pilot chutes or pins have been jostled loose because of that. So if you need, don't be ashamed to, I always ask for help when I'm in that position. I can't get up. So just be merry. And once you've done your gear checks, where should your rig be? Should it be against the fuselage, or be kind of like in a center?
Toward the center.
Towards the center. Yep. So just we're talking about situational honor. Be situationally aware. When you get in, look behind you and just kind of wait a second. Make sure all the seat belts are up. It's better to take a second and know that you have the correct seat belt than hurrying up, because then everybody else has to unseat belt or anything like that.
How about exit? I don't know if this falls into this, but exit order. Do we go over exit order of what we're doing?
We have not gone over exit order. Okay. So I'll try to go over this quickly. I got a few seconds.
But, sorry.
The first one's out, obviously, hop and pops. Then it's going to go to belly groups, the largest to the smallest.
What about movement groups?
Oh, movement groups. Correct. Yeah. There's a lot. Movement. Well, we're going to have one movement group first. All right. And here at Skydive Chicago, we have a policy. There is only one movement group if there's tandems or students aboard. All right. If not, if there is no tandems or students, the movement group can be first and last. Belly groups, okay, largest, smallest, and then free flight groups, largest to smallest, students, tandems, wingsuits, from there. Cool. What's that?
High pullers.
And then, yes, high pullers. And wingsuits are always last, okay? High pullers go out right before the wingsuits. If you want to know why, ask me afterwards, because you guys got to move on. All right.
Now, I really like this quote. Flying is not inherently dangerous, but very intolerant of errors. Okay? So, what does that mean? Nothing really happens when we're skydiving. Not very many incidences. No, you know, most of us have never, I don't think anybody here has been in a canopy collision before. Nothing really happens. So, in order to keep this prevention going, all right, we have a set of rules at Skydive Chicago that we're going to talk about. Now, for every rule that we have, there's at least 3 to 5 incidents that caused it, and usually a hospital trip or worse, okay? If you have any questions on any of the things we're about to talk about at any time, because they will forget to ask for questions at the end, just interrupt and go, okay? So, here we go. Your opening procedures. So, the right of way. You've opened up uneventful skydive, and you're faced with somebody else. What are you going to do? To the right, with your?
Rear riser.
Okay, why do we want to use our rear riser over a toggle?
Flatter.
Well, flatter. And? It's more immediate, right? Like, it's an instant reaction to the canopy. We don't have time to unstow our toggles or to play with our slide or anything. We're about to be in a canopy collision, right? So, the right of way, turn to the right. But turn to the right, unless? There's somebody there, seriously. Then? Turn left, seriously, okay? You'd be surprised. I've seen some serious videos before where people are just kind of offset like we are, and they're doing this huge 180 like this. Hi, yeah, no, we avoided that, great. Right, no. All that person had to do was turn 30 degrees to the left, and they would have avoided that entire situation, okay? Controllability check. Everybody has done this. Everybody does these every time they open. They're square, steerable, okay? Now, there, that can change with your experience level. You know, that can be, doesn't have to be a visual thing at some point. You can do it by feel. At some point, you're gonna know if your canopy is flying straight and if you have something good over your head without looking at it, right? You've jumped in enough times to know, okay, yeah, we're good, no problem. You know, you can look ahead. You can look for other canopies at that point. You know, avoid head-on collisions. Okay, perfect. Square and steerable. Now, steerable is very, very important. It is not a good idea to fly around or fly to your holding area with your brake stowed. Can somebody tell me why?
What if you have an issue when you need to unstall it?
Thank you. Literally.
Look, I seen that in Florida. A guy did that, and yeah, he spiraled in.
Seriously. Yeah. Okay. Unstow your brakes. For those who are more experienced and have housekeeping to do, cool. Then unstow your brakes. Okay. Unstow them before you're flying back to that holding area. All right. You could have a much more serious problem that you didn't plan for. Okay. And it's always the ones we don't plan for that get us. All right. When you get to your holding area. Flying to the holding area, please be diligent about keeping your head on a swivel. You're all flying to the holding area, every single one of you together at the same time, all right? Know how many people were in your group. Know where they are. They're gonna be the ones closest to you, most immediate to you. Know where the group in front of you is, okay? They're gonna be roughly clustered just like you are. Look at the one behind you. Know where people are. You have a potential of 21 other canopies in the sky with you. Per load, okay? Be diligent. Avoid flying up the line of flight. Everybody know what the line of flight is? There's another word for jump run, yes, which is the direction the plane is flying when we are jumping out of the plane. Know what jump run is. Not daily, not weekly, by the load, okay? Conditions change. We do our best to make sure everybody is informed on change jump runs, change landing directions, okay? We have our pilots make announcements in the airplane at the same time. Not everybody hears those sometimes, okay? So please check the winds aloft, check the board. Make sure you know exactly what's going on. Plan your skydives. So landing out, know when to bail. So this is your target. This is a long spot technique, okay? This is called the long spot technique. This is your target. Your target is doing this. Are you going to make your target?
No.
It's rising, right? This is your target. It's doing this. Are you going to make your target?
No. Overshoot it.
Yeah. You're going to overshoot it. Exactly. If you're going to overshoot it, that's not so bad. What are you going to do when you get back to overtop? Turn around, right? You're not going to overshoot because when you get to the point that you want to be at, you're just going to turn, right? Perfect. Now, the target, it's not moving. Are you going to make it?
That's where you're going
to
be.
That's where you're going to be. Now, is this an ideal scenario to be in? Why not? We don't have enough altitude to do a proper landing pattern. The goal is to reach our holding area with as much altitude as possible, all right? You'll see people spiraling on the way there, this, and then get put into a scenario that they could have so easily avoided if they would have just went to the holding area first and then started to do some turns, okay? Now, we say practice. This can be practiced. How can you practice landing out? It's so important. Well, long spot technique yourself. Pick a spot on the horizon. Start making adjustments with your canopy accordingly to see what that does to that target. All right. If we have the wind at our back and we are in a long spot, what input do we use to get back to our target? The wind is at our back. So I heard brakes. Why brakes?
To keep you afloat for longer, right?
Exactly. All right. So brakes will slow your forward speed down a little bit, but they dramatically increase time aloft, so time in the sky, right? With the wind at our backs, half brakes creates the slowest descent rate possible. Does everybody here know how to figure out half brakes on their canopy? Bring your toggles down until the little cat eye comes through the ring and double it. That's half, okay? Because all parachutes, except for the exception of a couple, are stowed at a quarter brakes. All right, so now the wind, you have a headwind coming at you and you have a long spot. What input are you gonna use? Rear risers. Does anybody know why? Well, we have a headwind, right? If we were going to pull our toggles down in a headwind, you're bringing the tail down, right? So you're creating more surface area. You've increased your time aloft, but with a headwind fighting you, well, you know, you've created a worse scenario. A little cheat I'll teach you that I actually didn't teach the other groups, so you're kind of lucky, all right? If the wind is not helping you, it's risers. If the wind is helping you, it's brakes. And that's in all scenarios, including crosswind, because technically that's a headwind. Obstacles, I'll go over there. Braked turns, okay? Wasn't even 2 years ago that somebody did a low turn into the ground over in Florida, and this person was insanely experienced. I'm talking one of the most talented canopy pilots out there. He was on one of the most prestigious demo teams, training with his team, didn't see somebody because he was trying to be accurate, low turn into the ground. A braked turn will save your life if you know how to do one. Does everyone know how to do one? Good, because we're gonna do one. Everybody put your hands all the way up. Good. Bend your canopy down to half, whatever that half is for you. All right, clear traffic, lift one side, and bring it back. Always clearing traffic. Ah, look at that, that's gonna save your lives one day. Awesome, perfect. The landing pattern at Skydive Chicago, left. We keep it very simple here for multiple reasons, all right? We have multiple aircraft and thousands of people visiting us. To say, oh, you can converge from both sides. Oh, you can do this, causes chaos. All right, it causes chaos, it causes accidents. There's no uniformity to it, nothing. There's no predictability. Having a set landing pattern, and I'll tell you why we chose left in a second, can help everybody else stay safe in the sky. All right, you stay predictable, because everybody enters the landing pattern at roughly the same altitude, right? You can stack nicely, there's nowhere everybody else is too, because everybody else is gonna be doing a left. Now, we say left hand only. If you can enter the pattern safely, if you cannot enter the pattern safely, please do a right-handed pattern. Seriously, if you can enter the pattern safely, doing a right, and you know there's nobody else coming around, do so. Please, we would rather see you make a good decision like that versus forcing yourself to do a long turn because you tried to make it to the other side of the landing area and start your left-handed pattern, okay? We have two designated landing areas. It's kind of Chicago. What is this? Yeah, perfect. So two designated landing areas, and there's a reason why we have separated them. They are separated by 1,000 jumps or higher, land close to the hangar. I'll show you where they are on the map. And anybody below that number lands a little bit further away. Now we have a runway converging into a taxiway here. So concrete to concrete on an angle. If you were to overshoot that main landing area, you didn't have much experience, you'll be overshooting into the concrete. So that's not an ideal situation, right? Now, knowing that, somebody with less experience could do a low turn to avoid that or make some other kind of mistake that can cause injury. So that's one of the biggest reasons we do that. The second is the location of the buildings. We don't want you flying over anything you don't want to land on. Another reason we have a left-handed pattern is on south days, we have high performance, the segregated landing areas is because we have high performance canopy pilots at this drop zone. Swooping is a privilege here, okay? We allow anybody to do whatever kind of turn they want as long as they do it safely. There are people here doing some pretty big turns, and when we're landing towards the south and you're flying over where we turn, you can cause a potentially dangerous scenario, not only for yourself, but for us as well, okay? And potentially other people when we have to try and avoid you, okay? So stick to your landing area. We'll go over here in a second. If you cross that magic line by a couple feet, we're not gonna come out there with the measuring tape and be like, ah, we got you, okay? It's about your mentality. That's what we're looking at. Do you respect the rules and why we have them? The runway, we do not cross the runway below 500 feet at Skydive Chicago, okay? It's 500 here. Normally, it is 1,000 feet at most airports. The reason we get wavered down is because this is a private airfield. There's only our aircraft taking off from here and landing here. So we can go down to 500 feet. Now, do not cross the runway below 500 feet. Think about that time where you were under canopy and somebody got way too close to you. You know, it almost ruined your day, right? Same thing happens to the pilots, you know. You're flying low over the runway. They don't know if you're gonna make it past. You know, they don't know if you're gonna be short. Are you gonna land on the runway? Are you gonna turn into them, away from them? It's too much, you know? So think of your pilot. When you think about crossing the runway under 500 feet, make these decisions earlier, okay? And pick one of the many off-landing sites that we have here. High-performance turns are, a privilege at this drop zone, okay? They are not a right, and your privilege can be taken away at any time for those high-performance pilots here, okay? We're trying to keep canopy progression moving forward while keeping everybody's safety at the top of our priority list. Learning. If you want to learn high performance turns, no problem. We can totally teach you. Come talk to me. We'll set you up with a progression that you can take with you instead of just sending it and hoping for the best, okay? Weather conditions. We live in the Midwest. This is Illinois. They can change so dramatically and so quickly. It'll be raining, and then it'll be sunny. You'll go up, and then a microburst of 40 miles an hour, a wind will come. And it's like, oh, great. Be diligent about knowing what the winds aloft are doing. Know what the ground winds are doing. We have screens all over the place filled with this information for your viewing pleasure, okay? Know what direction you have to face when you open. Know what direction you have to face when it's time to enter the pattern, before you enter the pattern. Know what they are doing all the way down, all right? This will make you a much more accurate and a much better canopy pilot. We do have an anemometer here. For those of you that don't know what that is, it's a fancy official term for a wind meter. Just ask Manifest. It's at the Manifest window, so please go outside to the first window, and they have it literally right there. Just open up the window. I just want to see the anemometer. They'd be happy to show you exactly what the winds are doing, okay? We also keep a detailed log on windy days, okay? So if you're curious as to what the winds were doing, okay, we have that information for you as well.
Where is that sensor located?
So the sensor is located on top of the wind tee. Oh no, right next to the wind tee. You see those in the very corner, there's a couple small flags. That's where the wind indicator
is. So that's
the
ground level.
Yes, that is ground level winds. The tee, does everybody here know how the tee works? The landing tee. Yes, when you can see a perfect tee, you're going the right direction. The way I like to think about it is we push the flat edge along. Okay, if you're pushing that flat edge, snow plowing away, or however you want to look at it, I don't know why I said that, it's fine. All right, you're landing in the right direction. If not, you've probably noticed you're moving much quicker than you intended to while you were landing. So we suggest turning around, doing a braked turn. I want to talk a little bit about turbulence, okay? Now, does everybody know how far turbulence can travel? It's okay. It's pretty far. Based on the wind conditions, turbulence can travel 10 to 20 times the height of the object in horizontal distance. Okay, this hangar is roughly 50 feet tall, let's call it that. That means, somebody want to do 10 times? 500, thank you. So 500 feet past this hangar, okay, you will feel turbulence. All right, on super windy days, 20 times the height past this hangar, you will still feel turbulent air. What is turbulent air? It's rolling air, it's chaotic, okay? It's the same kind of air that comes off the vortices off airplane props, all right? The same kind of turbulence occurs, it's just called mechanical, okay? Avoid the turbulence. How?
Stay away from the objects.
Stay away from the objects, exactly, right? If the wind is coming straight from this way, you can clearly see that it's hitting this object first. We have multiple different wind indicators in the landing area for you to notice that, okay? Land as far away from it as you can, all right? Avoid the turbulence. Now, talking a little bit about obstacles and different hazards that we have around here, I just want to mention that there are huge high voltage power lines along the north side, all right? I'm not talking about those power lines connecting to your house, I'm talking about the towers you see into the distance. So if you're long spotting, from the north side, please make sure you have enough altitude to clear those. If you do not, pick an off-landing site early. All right, I suggest that if you are long-spotted to the north or to the east, you raise your decision altitude by 1,000 feet for off-landings, okay? For the sole reason that there are few places to land on this side and on this side. You can fly onto the east side past everything, it's not that much. You can get to the other side on a high wind day, but not on the north side. The quarry stretches for so far. There's not much good stuff after it, okay? Other hazards, we have the river, of course, the Fox. Please avoid landing it at all costs. We do have a dam on the end. You will go over it. There's nothing to stop you from doing that, okay? We have the swoop pond, which is about to be no longer there for the new construction project, which is another obstacle you're going to have to avoid, okay? We have an out here, so these are the outs. We have one here, and real quick, these are good outs I'm about to point out, okay? These are relatively flat. There are no fences, no power lines, nothing. All right, we have one here. We have one here. Now this one, there are power lines here, okay? They are not connected, and I believe, this is an old photo, they're like back here, and I believe they run like this.
Kind of ends at the corner.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's that path right there.
It is that path right there.
It's not in the path 12 KV. Though, right?
It's single phase 12 KV.
In the path?
In the path.
Yeah.
But this is our not in the path though, it's gotta be next to it because we land here.
Well, next to it on the edge of the path, yes.
Perfect, okay, so not directly.
It's not in the middle of the
in the middle of this, okay. The next one we have is right here. This is much larger than it looks. If you can hit this line, please do. It's a safe place to land. This is way larger than it looks. This feels like a landing area in itself, okay. We have all these fields right here. And you have all of this, okay? Sorry, go ahead.
The fence on the north runway?
This one, yes. Running along here, along the entire north side of the property, thank you. All the way down from the edge of the runway where our property ends, there is a barbed wire fence. It's about yay tall, okay, for those of you who cannot see, all right? But it does not move. So you will stop, it will not move. One more thing, these little areas here that you can see that are kind of cut out, there's a reason that they do not plant anything there. This is eroded ground. They planted there. It was so bad that they just stopped doing it. It's uneven. It's muggy. It's ankle breaking or worse. It's not good places to land. Avoid empty little lines in the middle of fields like these. Okay, these are not ideal areas to land. Land in the crop, whatever it is. Okay, that's going to be flat because they planted there. Okay, one last note I will leave you on before we finish. There are no straight lines in the natural world. Okay, if you see straight lines, they are man-made. And because they are man-made, things come with that. Fences, ditches, power lines, all kinds of other hazards. So if you've picked a straight line, like a road or a driveway or something to land on, please keep in mind that that landing area is probably not going to be as safe as you think it is. Okay? Awesome. Thanks everybody for coming to this seminar.
Welcome to Safety Day, guys. Things are a little unusual tonight because I wasn't really expecting to be the format for this. But as you guys know, Rock Sky is no longer here, and I still am. I will continue to stay here as long as I can. I don't want anybody to push me out. So hopefully the people that come in and take over will be gracious, and they'll leave us alone, and they'll look in the door and go, "Hi, Rob," and they'll just do that, and we'll all be good. My name's Rob. I'm a senior rigger. I've been rigging for 20-plus years, and I started skydiving in 1998. I have about 1,200 skydives in 20-some years, so that tells you what I like to do. I like to work down here rather than skydive as much. Though it is fun, this is also where my love is. When I found skydiving, I actually found packing, and I went right to it. I got Tammy with me this year. Tammy's going to be helping down in the loft, so if you see her wandering around the drop zone, the questions you could give me, you can give her too, and hopefully she can come up with some answers for you as well. On that note, I'm going to kind of hand it over to her. She's going to describe what a rigger may do down here. And the floor is Tammy's.
So when you guys bring us a rig, assuming you're coming in for a repack, first we're going to have you practice your emergency procedures. Have a thing open up. How beautiful. Ooh, ah, it opened. And then we're going to hang it. And then we're going to thoroughly inspect all your attachment points, your grommets, your lines, your underskin, your top skin. No joke. Boring. Tough crap. Then we're going to look right up in here. And we're going to make sure it looks like that. Because funny thing, did you know there's going to be holes in your parachute? They're supposed to be there. Don't panic. It's not organic. Then we're going to come over here. We're going to check out your harness. We're going to check out all your hardware. The material. Make sure there's no funny holes. Make sure your BOC is tight.
Anyway, so... a lot of us skydive during the winter, or at least during part of the winter. Some of us skydive all year long. For those of you that skydive all year, you rely on your packers and riggers to keep an eye on your gear. You don't store it and put it away and walk away from it. So you have a good eye on it all the time. Some of us don't jump all year, like me. I didn't jump at all this year, this winter, which kind of sucked. But I put my gear away. I have to put it away somewhere nice that it's going to be maintained and it's not going to destroy the gear. I'm pretty sure there's somebody in here that keeps it in the trunk of their car. There's somebody here that keeps it in their garage. So these are the people I'm really talking to. I would really appreciate it if you would take your gear home, put it in your closet, nice, dark, dry, temperature controlled. Major fluctuations, like really hot heat, will cause the rubbers on your rubber bands to melt into your lines, can cause your nylon to stick together and melt together, things like that. So really hot is bad. Cold isn't as bad, as long as it's a stable cold. Major fluctuations in temperature, not so good for your gear, right? So when we take it home, put it in your gear bag, put it in the closet. You don't have to take it out and put it in a trash bag all fluffy anymore. That was when we had organic parachutes, and they would like stiffen together, and it was silk, so it was an organic, and if any moisture got in there, it was stuck together, things like that, right? So nowadays, you can just leave it in here, put it away for the 6 months of winter, the 2 months or whatever, but before you jump it, please make sure you break that out and repack it and then put it back in, okay? So what are you gonna look at when you first take it out of the closet? You're gonna look at the whole thing, right? We're gonna start at the bottom and we're gonna look at our BOC and make sure it's tight. Now for you belly jumpers, we can skip this level. For you free flyers, we want to make sure this doesn't slide out. Come on, guys. You know, you belly flyers, you know, you never, this never sees the wind. That's funny. Oh. Boy. So anyway, we want to make sure the pocket's tight, right, and holds this in place because we don't want this just slipping out. One, we're sitting on the floor of a plane and scooching. It's a good chance it could come out. Somebody in the door could knock it. Or you're sit flying and just the wind alone could catch this and pull these out. So make sure your BOC is tight and in good condition. Sometimes you'll see little white threads, that's the little rubber sticking out of it. Yeah, they're okay, but if it starts getting really bad, bring it on in, let's go ahead and change it, okay? That's an important thing. If you have one of these coming out early, it's gonna suck in that skydive. So the BOC in good shape. The rest of the container, the cloth, make sure there's no holes. Make sure that little mouse didn't build a little doorway right here so he could get inside, right? Look it over. Everything's in good shape. No holes, no rips, no tears. Holes and tears in this stuff will get bigger over time because we've got this cloth stretched. So if there's something there, bring it to my attention. May want to address it, okay? So the cloth is all in good condition. So we're going to flip over to our harness. Oh, the back pad, that's in good shape too. I forgot about him. And it looks great and soft and warm. The harness, that's an important part. Harness wears. These are like your tires. Every so often you may have to change something on there. If your hardware is causing a problem, it may cause a line across like that, right? And you're going to bring that to me. I'm going to say, sorry, no more skydiving today. We need to get that fixed right away. Pass that around, let them see. There's also the chance you're going to nick the edge of your harnessing, okay? I do not like broken threads on a harness. If I see broken thread ends, I want to replace it myself because loops. It's a solid continuous thread. If it's broken, pretty sure that weave's going to come undone. It doesn't take much of a hard opening if this is broke on the edge to get it started, right? And that's where it's going to rip is when it's opening. The chemical part, the garage, the back of the truck, that's bleach. That's what bleach does to your hardware. It's also so soft, I can rip it apart, right? Please do not put your gear in your garage. Keep this away from your webbing. So, the leg straps do not look like any of these things. Everything's in good condition. I'm happy with both leg straps. I'm gonna move up to the laterals, where the laterals attach to your container. Both sides in and out, make sure that's there, not slippy. Work your way up your harness to your handles. Your handles are tight. If you can do this, I'm okay with it. But if this happens while you're doing that, I'm not okay. I can replace these Velcros in here. It's not a big deal. If your handles are loose, please come see me. We want to address that. Again, if you're in the door with eight people and they're all chunked up tight and it goes and somebody has this handle and it's loose, you're going to have a parachute above your head. Kind of sucks. So make sure your handles and the Velcros are in great condition. That brings us to the chest strap. More hardware, no rust, no dings, no dents. Same with the chest strap with the leg straps. No nicks, no tears, no burrs, no nothing, please. These are also easy to replace on most gear. It's just right here, okay? We don't have to do a whole lot of work. After that, we're working our way up to our three rings. Of course, three rings are cloth, silver cloth, silver cloth. Make sure you see that cloth, silver cloth, silver cloth. If in doubt, have somebody look at it. Check the three rings, make sure they're in good condition. The little white loop that keeps your cutaway in place, please make sure that is in great condition, right? Make sure your RSL is connected correctly. That one didn't look funny because we were messing with it earlier. So that is the check of everything. You've looked at everything. We know this is in good condition now. Next thing is fire up your AAD. Make sure that's going to fire up. Cypresses, after 2016, they suggest you send it in every 5 years to get the electronics calibrated. You don't have to. It will quit flashing the number after a while and go back to normal operation. But do you know for a fact that it is still calibrated? No, we don't know that. That's why our airplanes, every couple of years, all the electronics get worked on. Everything gets reset. They're requesting every 5 years, and it's only $180 to do it. It could be off by 100 feet. It could be off by 1,000 feet. We don't know, right? Is it worth $180 to check? I send mine in. Sure. I want to be safe. So if your AAD is in that time frame and it's time to send it in, let's send it in.
How long does it usually take to get there and back?
To do the check on them? Average 4 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah, right now I'm at 6.
Right now we're at 6 weeks?
It's on its way back right now.
Okay, so we're at springtime. This is the worst time. If you know it's coming up, you can do it 6 months before and 6 months after the date on the older ones. And then now it's like a whenever, right? But if you have a time frame during the winter that you're going to be down, that's a great time because they're not as flooded with work. So you'll get it in the 4 weeks quicker, probably, for sure.
Waiting longer doesn't give you more time.
It doesn't help it any.
When your four-year date is up, if you say, I'm going to hold off 4 months, guess what? The service date is the four-year date.
The date's going to be...
You're saving time by saying, I'm going to keep holding it.
No, the dates are imprinted in the electronics. They already know when it was built. Those are the dates they're going to use. It's not the dates we want. Like, my birthday? Yeah. No. I want you to understand that the electronics do go off, and even though they suggest, I'm going to say it's a requirement because I really want you guys to have the utmost in safety. So that's that. Couple of things to keep an eye on your gear after you're skydiving. For a lot of people, your pilot chutes. Keep an eye on your pilot chutes where your handle's attached to it. This one doesn't have one, but this is where holes like to happen because we're pulling on that section right there, right? So keep an eye on your pilot chutes. You can hold them up to the light and look at the cloth. If it's a ZP or zero porosity, you should not be able to blow air in. If you blow air through a ZP, it's probably time to come see Rob and we're going to replace it because it's starting to get weak and it's not going to pull everything out as easily and as effectively as it should. The other place is where the D-bag is around the bridle. I want you guys to start keeping an eye on that on your gear. I'm finding a lot of these bridles that are, the line is encapsulated in it, but it's wearing a hole in the bridle right underneath in the D-bag, right? So when you guys have your parachute out on the ground, look inside hold that up, look at it real close, make sure. Because that is the section that causes the kill line to go funny where, right? You're either gonna get real fuzzy like this cute little monkey right here, or you're gonna get weird and sickly looking like this side right here. But if a kill line gets to this stage, I want to replace it, right? It's only $40. If I find it during the repack, I'm gonna do it anyway and not ask permission. I'm gonna ask forgiveness, the Skydiver way. So kill lines are important, right? The parachute, the pilot chute will still activate. It will still work. It just won't collapse after the deployment. So if you're on a bigger parachute, you'll never even notice that this didn't do its thing like it should. You'd never notice. But if you're on the smaller ones like Daniel or some of these other guys fly, an open parachute behind a parachute actually does cause a little bit to the performance of it. So these are things I want you guys to keep an eye on. It's maintenance, like kicking the tires on your car every week, month, whatever you guys do with that. Anyway, so that's that. Any questions on any of this? Did I miss anything? Is there something I forgot? I love it. Everybody's like, oh, what does he know?
How do we know if the rigger seal is routed correctly?
How do you know if the rigger seal is
routed correctly? Or
routed correctly?
Yes.
Because you will not be able to remove the pin without breaking the thread. No matter how they do it, there's a couple of different ways. I do different than what most people do, but what I do is legal as well, right? It no functional difference. It's just looks different. But if you can move this pin, remove it without breaking that seal thread and somehow get it all back with that thread back on there, that's not a good seal, right? So that thread should be tight enough that you can't do anything with it. That's why the seal. Yeah. Okay. Yes?
So when it comes to back to the Cypress, like centering it off to get recalibrated, you would want to do that when you do get your repack done?
That's,
you got to take it out and then you got to put it back in, right?
That's the best time to do it. Yes.
What about other brands that don't have, like a Mars?
Vigil doesn't say send it. Mars doesn't say send it.
I didn't send mine but in 12 years.
I know. But what did you get? You got upgraded software,
yeah.
Right? You got new software in it. You got new batteries in it. So Vigil every 10 years has to go in for a battery, okay? And when they get it, they automatically do a software update and whatnot with that battery change. Mars has no requirements yet, but it doesn't mean you can't in 4 or 5 years call them up and say, hey, look, I've been jumping your unit. I have concerns. I want to be safe. Do you have a program? They're going to say, hell yeah, send it to us. And they're going to get it and do their what they do to it, and they'll send it back to you with a certificate.
Life to the Cypress ones, because you can only do that one so many times before they say it's done.
All of these have life. They all have a life. Each one is a little different, but yeah, they all have a death rate. So it's electronics. We don't want to carry it too far. Even if it does work, they've only tested it so far. So we're going to stay within those bounds. But yes, they have lifetimes.
Yeah, like how did Vigil come out with 20 years if they were only out for like 8 years when I got it?
Well, no, they've been out for a while. They had been 10 years or so by the time you got it, but they weren't doing, it wasn't commercially available right away. It was in a test series, and then there was other places. Like the Czechoslovakian Mars, the M2, actually was in the military for years before it ever went public. But we know it works. Cutaway cables, if you guys clean your own cutaway cables, please remember some containers have a split cutaway cable housing so that we can include a Collins lanyard to it to assist in clearing the long side of your cutaway cable when you use it. On the SunPath rigs, you will find it on the shoulder, right? That is the Collins lanyard attached to it. So when you clean cables on a sun path, you have to make sure they route correctly through this. Similar situation on a vector, but it will be up in the top here, right? So when you pull the cables out and you're feeding them back in, you want to make sure you get through all of the proper elements that are there. If you don't know and are in doubt, have somebody with you that does know and can help show you and lead you through it, and then after that you will be amazingly experienced at it.
Yeah, if you guys don't do that, your mark system won't.
Yeah, no, you have to have that Collin lanyards on the cutaway cable. It's all a part of the system. Everybody, all the instructors, everybody wants to help teach you what these lanyards do, what time they operate in all of the function. We want you guys to know that because it's what gear you might have on your back. You need to know how it operates, okay? So at some point, anytime, find somebody, ask questions, definitely. That's all I got. Any more questions?
So some of the concepts that we're going to talk about here, if you guys work in a corporate environment, you've probably heard of some of this stuff. And it's safety culture. So it's a prevalent idea. It's something that there's a lot of folks within the skydiving community that are trying to bring this idea of safety culture into the skydiving world because it can make a big difference for us. So culture is to a group what personality or character is to an individual. So culture is a way of life for a group of people. As an organization, as a group of skydivers, we have a culture. As an individual drop zone, you have a culture. And the good thing about having a culture is everyone in this room has the ability to shape what that culture is. What your morals are like, what your values are like, what your goals are, and what our customs will look like as a sport. So we went over these numbers already. Obviously, when we talk about safety, one of the first things that we come up with is we think about fatalities and how many fatalities there are. So obviously we talked about a little bit earlier how the number of fatalities in our sport is decreasing, but we've still got a way to go. You know, there's still, we talked about the different fatalities, what caused each one of them and why they occurred and what we can do to stop them in the future. But in order to make those changes, we really need everyone to get involved with that process. Right, we took a look at fatalities by license, and we see obviously that we have a concern when we start out, we're really on top of things, and as we move along, complacency kicks in. We don't necessarily get smarter. We have the potential to become more complacent. So what we're going to talk about, and I've tried to break this down into three safety values to try and keep it somewhat simple to follow. First is normalization of deviance. Second, watch out for each other. And third, being self-leadership. So we're going to touch on each of these three items and how they can relate into creating a better safety of culture for you as an individual and for your drop zone. Normalization of deviance. So this term was coined by an American sociologist named Diane Vaughan, and it describes a process of which deviance from a correct or proper behavior becomes normalized in a culture. A process where a clearly unsafe practice comes to be considered normal if it does not immediately cause a catastrophe, a long incubation period before a final disaster with early warning signs that were misinterpreted, ignored, or missed completely. Now, if you think about that and relate it to skydiving, you can probably come up with some examples either in your life or that you've seen at the drop zone. So she came up with this term originally when the Challenger disaster occurred back in 1986. After that disaster occurred, there is a lot of studying that went on into figuring out what caused that disaster. Obviously, the direct cause of it had to do with a failed O-ring. But what they looked at was the root cause of it, which was a four-year pattern of shortcutting safety practices at NASA. And it came to be found to be normalization of deviance in that corporate culture at NASA. They discovered that, they figured it out, and then you would think once they figured it out, there are a bunch of rocket scientists. Of course, they didn't let that happen again. They fixed that problem. Unfortunately, 17 years later, it happened again. The same normalization and deviance occurred at NASA again, and there was the shuttle Columbia, which crashed on reentry into Earth's atmosphere. If it can happen to a rocket scientist, it can happen to us. If you look into medicine, you'll see it. If you look into firefighting, first responders, they all teach these types of concepts. So who was around back when the Challenger disaster occurred?
10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start. 4, 3, 2, 1. And liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th space shuttle.
So the delays he talked about at NASA were because there were a lot of differences of opinion on whether or not they should have moved forward with that launch, and a lot of people who kind of were whistleblowers to the issues that were going on and the changes they were making that were ignored. So how does that work, and how does that happen, and how can it apply to us? So has anybody ever seen this picture before? It's called a deviation spiral. Right? So we're going to walk through what this looks like and how this can affect us as skydivers. So first off, in the middle, let's talk about what would be our normal operating procedure. So let's take a skydive, for instance. You put your rig on, you buckle everything up, you do your handle checks, you check your gear, you go to the boarding area, you talk about what you're going to do on the skydive with all the people around you, you get on the plane, you put your seatbelt on, and you take off. Now let's say you are headed and you're on a jump and you have to go to the bathroom. So you go in the bathroom, you come out and you're on a short call. So you take your rig, you throw it on, you don't do a gear check, you go to the boarding area, you work out your exit order, you get on the plane, you put your seatbelt on, you go up and you do your jump. Well, let's say nothing happens, right? You're not met with an immediate failure or catastrophe from not doing that gear check. So next time around, you don't do it, right? Your deviation is that you failed to do your gear check. There was no failure or immediate catastrophe, so your new normal becomes that you don't do gear checks. Next jump comes around, and you had to go get a cheeseburger that you were waiting for. You're eating it, you threw your gear on, you don't do gear checks anymore because you don't need to do that. You go to the boarding area, you work your boarding area out, and you just, for some reason, you forget to put your seatbelt on, right? You take off, you go, you do your skydive. You're not met with an immediate failure or catastrophe. So that becomes your new normal. You're now at new normal number two. Next one comes around and something else happens and you forget to get to the boarding area on time to work out exit order, right? So now you're not doing gear checks. You're not working out your exit order with everybody else on the plane. You're not putting your seatbelt on anymore, and you continue in this pattern, right? You keep changing and you keep deviating from what is considered normal best practices and normal safe procedures, and as long as each one of those that happens, you're not met with an immediate failure or negative consequence, that becomes your new normal until eventually, after that long incubation period, you end up so far away, you're at new normal 3 or 4 or 5, you're so far away from what is considered normal best practices that eventually that catastrophe hits. And when you look at it in hindsight, and the people who are around you look at it afterwards and they go, geez, how did we get here? How did we get so far from what we all know is safe practice? Well, that's how it happens. It's one at a time. And if we're not met with an immediate failure, we continue on. So next up, we're going to talk about something called predictable surprises. Two gentlemen, a gentleman named Max Bazerman and Michael D. Wadkins, wrote a book about this. And they break them down into three categories. The first is cognitive or psychological vulnerabilities. So we ignore threats or predictable surprises. Scholars refer to it as cognitive bias, right? So we tend to harbor illusions that things are better than they actually are. We give great weight to evidence that supports our preconceptions and discount evidence that calls those preconceptions into question. We're creatures of the present, so we will deal with small pain now in order to rather than deal with a lot of pain later, right? So we will take the path of least resistance, right? Most of us don't feel compelled to prevent a problem that we have not personally experienced or has not been made real through pictures or vivid information. So even though we know that skydiving can be dangerous, unless it affects us directly, we have a cognitive bias or a psychological vulnerability to not see it as real. Unless you've seen the broken bone or unless you've had to deal with it directly, you have a cognitive vulnerability to think it can't happen to you, right? So we have to learn to overcome these vulnerabilities so we don't fall prey to them. The second type of predictable surprise that they talk about are operational. And those are when we fail to take active steps. We can talk about that in the drop zone format as operating in silos. So this is a pretty big drop zone. There's a lot of moving parts to it, right? There's fun jumpers, there's pilots, there's management, there's an AFF program, there's tandems, there's video people. And an organizational vulnerability can be as if those different parts of the drop zone do not communicate, right? If you see something as a fun jumper that affects the pilot, say something. If you're in the manifest office and you see something that could affect the AFF program or the fun jumpers, say something. There has to be communication. So there's a natural vulnerability to predictable surprises if you do not do that, if you don't see that vulnerability as an organization. Political vulnerabilities, they give some good examples of that. They talk about 9/11, the 1993 car bombing of the World Trade Center, things that and biases that we have in our political views or our political culture that allow us not to see what's happening. So normalization of deviance leads to predictable surprises, right? So if we don't see these things coming, we only see what we see. We don't think things are real because we cannot imagine them happening to us. We pay too little attention to what other people are doing. That can lead to our worst nightmare, right? So a few questions and examples. Have you ever gone on a jump and looked at your rig and said, I'll replace that closing loop on the next jump, knowing that it needed to be changed, right? Have you ever gotten on the plane when you knew the winds might have been slightly over limits? Right, predictable surprises, easy. Have you ever gotten to the door and looked out and couldn't see the landing area, but you got out anyway? Because the group before you did and there were people behind you waiting, right? These are things where you can have a predictable surprise, right? They exist in every part of our lives. You can probably think of an example where you have something like this in a relationship, where you've seen something but you've ignored it, or possibly in your health, right? We talked about health and mental and physical wellness. Well, you know, maybe you were eating something that you shouldn't have been, or maybe you acted a certain way that you knew was not in the best interest of your own health, but you did it anyway. Next part we're going to go to is topic two. Does anybody have any questions on normalization of deviance? So we're going to keep it. There was a lot in that one. but it's an important one. Second up is teamwork. We are all vulnerable. You're vulnerable, I'm vulnerable. As a group, we are vulnerable. Risk has no memory, and this is a very difficult one that took me a while to get to. I had to read this sentence over and over and over again, probably about 10 times before it sunk in. But risk is not diminished as a function of your success in repeatedly taking a risk. Risk is not diminished as a function of your success in repeatedly taking a risk. Risk has no memory. Risk has no history. Just because you do something and you're not met with an immediate negative consequence does not mean next time you go to do that same action that the risk does not exist. It is still there. It's still present. It still has the ability to hurt or kill you, right? So that's a tough one for skydivers. I know it was tough for me. Like I said, I had to read that sentence about 10 times, and I looked at it the first probably 5 or 6 times, and I'm like, no, that's wrong. That's wrong. Of course the risk is reduced the more I do something. Well, it's not. And the sooner we realize that it's not, the sooner we can move past that and learn. Second up, plan the jump, jump the plan. We use this term a lot in skydiving, but a lot of the time when we say plan the jump, jump the plan, we're talking about the skydive, right? The points we're making on a skydive. I'm gonna dock here, you're gonna dock there, we're gonna do this point first, that point first. But if you back that up, they use this term in the military as well. It's plan the flight, fly the plan. But it has to do with more than just what you're gonna do. Back that up a little bit and talk about what you're gonna do in your pre-jump planning. You know, do you have a procedure for putting on your gear? Do you have a procedure for doing your gear check? Do you, as a drop zone and the people who jump here, have a process when you get to the boarding area of what you're gonna do, right? What are you gonna do in the aircraft? And today, going through EPs and things like that and talking about aircraft emergency stuff like that today is a good part of that process. But you have to continue to reinforce them throughout the entire year, right? Same thing, once the skydive is over, what's your plan after the jump, right? Walk through your emergency procedures and assume that things are gonna go wrong, right? That's how you beat those predictable surprises. Assume that when you throw that pilot chute out, it's not gonna be there square and steerable, right? Assume something's gonna go wrong. When you do your gear check, play a game and assume that one of your friends changed your gear, right? And that you've got to find what he did wrong, right? Consider your instincts. If something's wrong, ask a question. Don't just assume it's okay and keep going, right? Everybody's part of the team. It takes everyone here to make the drop zone safer. 100%, everyone. Archive and review. And we did a bit of that today by looking at the fatality summary. USPA does a lot of this, looking at fatalities and also non-fatal incidents. Most of us probably look at those once at safety day, and then we move on, right? Take the time to look at them again. When you get about midway through the year, go back and pick up the April issue of Parachutist and read through those lessons learned again. Look at in the back of every magazine, every month, there are non-fatal incidents reported that talk about what happened and what you can learn from it. So archive what occurred and take the time to review it and learn from the mistakes of others. So safety culture at your drop zone. Make procedural compliance a religion. So I've been to a lot of drop zones in my time, and there was one drop zone I went to that I watched the landing area. I watched the load go up and I watched everybody land, and everybody did a perfect pattern, right? They all landed the same way. Nobody did a big turn, nobody landed the wrong way, nobody went backwards to the pattern. And I noticed it. I was like, wow, that's really good, because you don't see that at every drop zone. So I watched the next load, and it was the same thing. And I watched the load after that, and it was the same thing. And I went and asked the DZO, who was a friend of mine, I said, how do you do that? And his answer was basically that they drill it into everyone's head from day one, and everyone's a part of it. So if someone violates that landing pattern or that process, then it's not the job of the DZO or the SMTA to go talk to that person who did it wrong. It's whoever's standing closest to them in the landing area, right? So everyone is involved. everyone at the drop zone. Somebody goes up to him and says, "Hey, man, you know, I'm curious. Is there a reason that you went the wrong way through the landing area?" And a lot of the time, they'll go, "Yeah, did you see that? That was really cool. I went downwind. Oh, I was going so fast." But the response to that isn't, "Yeah, you looked really cool." It was, "No, you actually endangered me and my friends on that skydive. So that's not cool here, and that's not what we do. So it'd be really awesome if you could, you know, allow all of us to have fun and let's all land the same way." And the person would put their head down and walk inside. And then the next time, that was the guy yelling at somebody else who did it wrong. So they got everyone involved, and that's what it takes. It takes everyone. So the third topic is self-leadership, right? So we talked about normalization of deviance. We talked about teamwork and everyone getting involved. And the third topic is self-leadership. Don't be a passenger, right? This is a big drop zone. You're all here. Everybody's here having fun. You're all part of this community. Don't be a passenger in the process. It takes everyone involved to make sure we don't have issues, right? Negotiate through normalization of deviance and stay laser focused on your goal of keeping your DZ as safe as possible, right? There's, who's in the military? Anybody in the military? Okay. There's a term in military aviation called bingo fuel, and it's a point in a training exercise where you have just enough fuel to make it back to your intended landing area or an alternate landing area, right? And that's the point where you stop your training exercise and you go back, right? So think of that concept in the form of skydiving, in freefall skydiving, right? You have a point where you stop doing what you're doing. Have you ever been on a jump and said, "Okay, we're at breakoff altitude, but we're almost at that grip. Should we go for it?" Right? That's your bingo fuel. You're passing it, right? And you're borrowing time for the predictable surprise that could happen later. Right? That's where it all trickles down. And every time there's an accident or an incident, there's always multiple steps in the process where decisions were made that weren't necessarily right, and they compile on top of each other. All right, so don't fall prey to that. Think of bingo fuel. If you have a breakoff altitude, stick to it, because that breakoff altitude affects your decision altitude, and it affects everything that starts happening from there down. Right? Maintain your presence at your DZ. Whether you have 1,000 jumps, or 100 jumps, or 20 jumps, ask questions, be a part of the conversation. All right? It doesn't mean just because you have 20 jumps that you can't get involved in the conversation. Fourth thing, groupthink. This is what we were just talking about. Psychological phenomenon that occurs within a group of people, which the desire for harmony or conformity in the group results in an irrational or dysfunctional decision-making outcome. All right, everybody gets together, and there's one person that overpowers the group and gets everybody going in one direction, which might not be the right one. Right, so ask questions, don't be a passenger. Question what may be perceived authority when appropriate, and be part of understanding and learning, right? And it takes 100% participation, right? If we're going to get to a time when we have zero fatalities in our sport, the only way to do that is to have 100% participation. Right? We have to have everyone involved, because it only takes one person doing the wrong thing or making the wrong decision, not being involved in teamwork, not realizing that normalization of deviance, not being a self-leader, not getting involved to create a catastrophe. So it takes everybody. All of you folks have started. You're not necessarily the problem with that, but you are the ones that now bear the responsibility to go on and teach it to others. We're coming near the end. Last slide. So is this stuff real? So let's talk a little bit about some of the aircraft accidents that have happened recently. The King Air crash in Hawaii in 2019 killed all 11 folks on the aircraft. Aircraft crash was attributed to aggressive takeoffs, and it led to a stall of the aircraft. The pilot was known to do this on numerous occasions. People knew it, people saw it after they talked about it afterwards. Normalization of deviance. Ultimately, it led to 11 people dying. And that crash affects everyone in this room because to this day, I still spend a good chunk of my week working on fighting potential legislation that's gonna come that's gonna affect our entire sport. And it's basing out of that incident in Hawaii and the politicians in Hawaii that are looking to push additional regulation on our sport because of it. So what happens somewhere else affects everyone. So the Queen Air crash in 1995 also killed everyone on board. The aircraft, that was attributed to insufficient pre-flight of the aircraft. All 12 died. The pilot, 10 skydivers, and a preacher who was sitting on his back porch reading a Bible and was hit by the crashing plane. Afterwards, when they talked to people, they said that the plane's engine was making a funny noise, but nobody did anything about it, right? Everybody had heard it for weeks. When we see things like this, it's our responsibility to ask questions, talk about it, and be leaders in our communities, right? So skydiving incidents, can you guys think of anything that might relate to one of these type of topics that you've heard of? Or anything either you've seen or maybe anything you've done that you want to mention?
There was a canopy collision during Rookie Fest. That's the one I can think of.
Okay, canopy collision during Rookie Fest.
Oh, you're looking more for towards pavement.
Okay, what happened?
I can't say much, I didn't see it, but we definitely took it seriously though.
Okay.
And the winds were picking up, and we're trying to, I think the height level of everything was going on that day, going very, very quick, and then it finally was a collision.
Okay.
It was the time to slow everything down. And part of that was a younger people going too fast. Which may have not led to that exact change in the relationship, but you know, it's a serious one.
Yeah. Yep. People maybe got out of their normal flow of things. They started deviating from what they're normally doing, trying to keep up. You know, that the example I gave, rushing with the cheeseburger to try and get to the plane, and they forget to do things, right? Whether that's physically forgetting to do something, like checking your gear, or mentally forgetting to do something, right? Because we all have to be mentally prepared to go on skydives. That's a big part of it, right? We got to mentally be in the right place. Whether it's if you've had too much to drink the night before and you're not mentally there, step back. If you're rushing to the aircraft, you're not mentally in the place you're supposed to be. Right, you need to have your wits about you. You need to be on cue with everything you're doing to make sure you're ready for the skydive, right? Short field takeoff. I had a really good example of a time I was in an airplane. I was getting in for a competition. I got in the plane, pilot taxied out and did a short field takeoff, which means you only use half the runway, right? And he took off the aircraft. But when he landed, I didn't think much of it. I didn't know much back then. But a friend of mine who was on the plane, he went up to the pilot, and he very politely explained to him that if he ever did that again, he talked about what he would physically do to the pilot, and it wasn't very nice. So he took an active role in realizing that there was a safety shortcut being taken in order to save, you know, 30 to 60 seconds of back taxiing. And he stood up and said, I'm not gonna stand by and let this safety shortcut be taken. So have you ever been in a situation where the aircraft flies beyond its operational limits for entertainment, right? That's gonna be a big part of our sport, right? There's incidents like that that happen, and when they happen and they end in a fatality or an airplane crash, it threatens our entire ability as a community and as a sport to continue to self-regulate ourselves, right? USPA is the arm of our ability to self-regulate. If we can't keep from crashing our own aircraft, someone else will step in and regulate us, right? So if you see that kind of stuff happening, don't laugh and enjoy it, because it will be probably the number one thing that will cause the end of our sport as we know it. So if you see that kind of stuff happening, don't find it acceptable. Talk to the pilot, talk to the DZO, and let them know it's not cool, it's not okay, and don't do it. Last note, what we did yesterday doesn't matter. That's behind us now. Let's try and apply these concepts, the three things we learned, right? Remember, normalization and deviance, teamwork, everybody here is in it together, and self-leadership, right? So take an active role in being safer at your drop zone. So thanks for listening. Hope you guys enjoyed it.
Yeah. Wonderful. All right, so it's time you've all been waiting for, the raffle. Woo! Okay. So I'm just going to use a random number generator, and these are all in random order, minus the one that Anthony just took. But it includes prizes from Option Gravity, the PD Gear Store, Fluid Wings, Cookie, and some jump tickets from SDC. So, let me... And if I can't read your handwriting, then you should have written your name clearly. All right, so what do we have up, number one?
We have the certificate is good for 15% off any standard wing from Fluid Wings.
All right, 15% off Fluid Wings is number 75, Ray. Ray, are you here?
I'm a Ray.
Yeah, Ray, number 75. Nope, I'm probably not trying anybody's last name due to both reading and spelling. Okay, number two.
This is a free G4 from Cookie.
Ooh, a free G4. Number 55, Betsy. Oh, she left. Okay. Well, I guess we have to draw it again, because you have to be here. Number two, Graham.
Oh, fuck yeah. I want to thank Betsy.
Yeah. Send her a picture of it. All right, next.
This is 15% off another Fluid Wings canopy.
15% off Fluid Wings. Number 71, it looks like Jonathan, 71.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Missy from Fluid Wings accidentally sent me four, so we have quite a few of those instead of two, but she told me I could use all of them. All right, next.
This is 10% off everything from Option Gravity.
So anything from Option Gravity. Number 10, Emily H. Emily Hine. You won something. You won 10% off anything from Option Gravity. Okay, and next.
This is another G4.
Another G4. Number, oh, no one's number 45. Number 15, Caitlin. You won a G4, a free G4. All right, next.
This is two free lift tickets.
Two lift tickets to Skydive Chicago. Number 32, Val. Oops, it says it must be used by April 1st, 2022, but it's supposed to say 2023, yes. April Fools.
All right, this is another 15% off standard wing from
Fluid Wings. 15% off Fluid Wings. 67, Cody. All right.
This is a $100 credit for the PD gear store.
$100 to PD. Number 14, Dennis C. Yay! All right.
Another two tickets for at Skydive Chicago.
Two more Skydive Chicago lift tickets. Number 42 doesn't exist. Number 27, Sally. Yeah! Yeah. Yeah.
And here is two more tickets for Skydive Chicago.
The last two lift tickets for Skydive Chicago. 47 doesn't exist, neither does 50. 35. Andrea.
Andrea.
Yep.
Yeah. 20% off anything from Option Gravity.
Option Gravity, 20% off. Crippen. Oh, sweet.
This is for 30% off anything for Option Gravity.
30% off, Option Gravity. Number 70, looks like Dan D. Dan, with a D. Dan something, yeah.
And the last one is 15% off anything, Canopy from Fluid Wings.
15% off Fluid Wings. We'll see. Oh no.
What is it?
I'm so excited. All right. Yeah, exactly. All right, number 7, Sam K. Yay! Yeah. All right, I think that's it. As soon as we're done, if everybody who got a certificate can just come up so we can take a picture, that'd be fantastic.
All right, guys, so that concludes 2022 Safety Day. Hope everybody learns something and gets refreshed. Again, tomorrow, if you're here for a currency, you need to meet tomorrow at 9 a.m. and we're going to go over EPs so we can get you up. Thanks a lot, guys.